Exercise in civic engagement. I'm Robert Price. I'm the executive editor of the Bakersfield Californian, and TBC Media is excited to bring this event tonight, California's Energy Future. We've brought together some excellent panelists, and we're excited to have a great partner in this event, CALmatters. And at this time, I'd like to introduce our moderator, the editor-in-chief of CALmatters, David Lesher.
Thank you very much, Bob. I am really excited about this night for several reasons. One is that we have a spectacular panel here tonight. I mean, we have very top-level people. We have a diversity of perspectives on a very important issue in California, and an issue that really I think we should talk more about in California. It's the magnitude of the changes we're making are pretty significant. And I really think, you know, this panel is the best panel discussion I have seen on this topic anywhere in California since a lot of these policies passed last summer in SB 350, Senate Bill 350. So I know we have an audience out in live stream land tonight, and as well as here in Bakersfield. I'm also very excited about tonight because CALmatters is pretty new. We just launched last summer publicly, and this is our very first public event. And so I'm very happy to be able to co-host it with the Bakersfield Californian. And so a special thanks to Richard Bean, the publisher. And Richard and I, you know, small story, we go back to the LA Times about 25 years ago. And my wife is here, and we're married 27 years, and Richard loaned us his Fodor's travel guide to Spain for our honeymoon, so small world. And Bob Price, the editor of Bakersfield, he and I have been working together to put this together, and it's been a lot of fun. So I want to say just a little quick description about CALmatters, because we are very new and very different. We are an independent, nonprofit journalism startup based in Sacramento. We have a staff of reporters and editors. We do stories on state policy topics. You know, we do education and healthcare and environment. We've done roads and poverty, and we give our stories to newspapers and radio stations all around the state. So we have been published in more than 40 papers around the state and a couple dozen public radio stations. So we describe ourselves as, you know, the largest news organization in California today that's covering these topics. There's a couple members from the CALmatters team here today I want to point out in the bleachers here. Simone Cox is our chair of the board. And next to her is Chris Boskin, another board member. And Kazar Kampwala, who's the president of CALmatters. So we're very grateful to be here to be able to co-host this event. So a little word about our format tonight and then some announcements. I am going to give just a quick overview of some of the climate policies in California, just so our speakers don't have to speak to that background. And also we're trying to make this not too much of a wonk fest. So, you know, for people who aren't too much up to speed with some of these issues, we'll try and explain a little bit about the policies that we're gonna be talking about. I would urge you to silence your cell phones. Like I said, this is being live streamed, and I should do that myself. This is being live streamed, so you don't want your embarrassing ringtone going out into cyberspace, and you never know where it might end up. And then I have no light here, so I got to take a look at my notes now and then, I think. A note to our panel, we have five members of the panel, and we have a lot of ground to cover. So, you know, just encouraging the discussion to move along and not take too long. I'm also going to be something of an acronym cop. As the panel knows, there's a lot of acronyms that have to do with this issue, and I'm going to ask the audience to understand one, and that is CARB. CARB is the California Air Resources Board, and CARB is very influential in the issues we're talking about, and if we have to say California Air Resources Board every time, we're going to be here all night. So if you could remember CARB, we'll try and stay away from LCFS and RPS and WISPA and all the other things. I thought we might try and demonstrate how cap and trade works by having an acronym jar on the table, but I didn't know if that would be a fee or a tax or what, and so that was a... After I give a little background, I'll introduce the panel, and then I will ask a couple questions and then open it up to questions from the audience. So, just quickly, the background, go back 10 years, 2006, Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger on the shore of San Francisco Bay signed AB 32, the Assembly Bill 32. It's the Global Warming Solutions Act. In essence, it said that we are going to, as California, lower our greenhouse gas emissions to 1990 levels by the year 2020. The California Air Resources Board is assigned to come up with the policies and the regulations to achieve those goals. That's why it's so important. There's a lot of policies that have been worked on, but there are three that I want to mention. One is our cap and trade program that we adopted under AB 32. Cap and trade, I think we have the biggest cap and trade program in the whole world, I believe. Cap and trade is essentially CARB tells many of the people or companies that emit greenhouse gases, here's how much you can emit. If you emit more than that, you have to buy carbon credits. If you emit less, you can purchase or you can sell carbon credits. So cap and trade. The second policy that is significant is the renewable portfolio standard. It says that basically by the year 2020, we are supposed to get a third of our electricity from renewable sources like wind and solar and things like that. And the third is the low carbon fuel standard. And I'm not going to try and explain what it is, but just suffice to say that it's a cap and trade style financial incentive to get cleaner fuel and more alternative fuels like biofuels and things like that. So about a year ago, CARB did a projection about and said we are on track to reach those 2020 goals. And a few months after that, Governor Brown, in his State of the State just last year in 2015, said we're on track to meet those 2020 goals, so let's set some new goals for 2030. And those goals, he put out three of them. One is that by 2030, we are supposed to get 50% of our electricity from renewable sources, up from 33% in 2020. The second one was that we are supposed to increase the energy efficiency of our buildings in California, whether it's government or business or even residential, by 50% by 2030. And the third was that we would reduce our fuel consumption by 50% by 2030. So that bill was introduced, the Senate Bill 350, last year by Kevin DeLeon, the president of the Senate. And it went through the Senate, went past the Senate very easily, and it went to the Assembly where the fuel consumption reduction provision was stripped out. And so the bill passed without that, but the governor has said since then that he hopes to achieve that goal anyway through executive orders and regulation. So that is the overview. I hope that helps understand the conversation we'll be having today. And I think you can see from those policies that this is a perfect panel to talk about this. You know, I'll make some quicker introductions. You have a program that has some fuller introductions, but starting at the left end of the table, or my left, your right end of the table, Kathy Reheis Boyd is the president of the Western States Petroleum Association, which is the trade and lobby group for the oil industry in the Western States. Next to her is Dean Flores, just appointed last month to the California Air Resources Board, which CARB, remember that. And Dean is a former state legislator who served in the Assembly and the Senate from here in Kern County. He's a Democrat. Next to him is Senator Gene Fuller, the senator from Bakersfield, who is also the Republican leader of the state Senate. And next to her is Todd Strauss, Vice President at Pacific Gas and Electric, who oversees a lot of their work on clean energy issues. And next to him is Paul Geip, who is a renewable energy analyst and the author of 7 books on wind energy. So you can see we have quite a good panel and a diverse panel, and get right to it. The first question I just wanted to look back. Like I said, we've been at this for 10 years now since AB 32 passed, and just kind of get a rec- report card and lessons learned and thoughts about how we've done, what the experience has been like with AB 32. And I'd say one thing, you know, when SB 350 was introduced, the governor and Senator De Leon described, said it has been successful because here we are, the economy's doing well, and we're on track to reach the 2020 goals. So it's time to increase the goals. So so I'd like to start out with just that report card and check in with everybody about it. And I'd like to start with Todd Strauss, if I could.
Sure thing. Thanks, Dave. So just to clarify for the record, because accuracy is very important, I'm actually not vice president, but senior director, energy policy, planning analysis. Okay. I appreciate the promotion.
You got it.
So with respect to AB 32, you use the words on track, quoting CARB, and successful, quoting the governor, and absolutely the case. The thing is, in California, everything is complicated because we are so ambitious. We're trying to achieve a lot, many different things at the same time. And so it's important to note, and I'm sure, Dean, you'll get a good taste of this. In AB 32, there are about 18 different programs that attempt to get greenhouse gas reductions. And perhaps one of the most prominent ones is cap and trade. You described that earlier a little bit there, Dave. It's important to note, in Europe, they have a cap and trade program. There's a program in the northeastern United States. No doubt, when you look across the world, California's program has been the most successful. Its launch was deliberate. We've actually been able to achieve greenhouse gas reductions. Prices have remained relatively low. The market hasn't gone crazy, which is one of the concerns. And most importantly, it still has the potential to serve as a model for the rest of the world. So for example, Quebec has joined and linked with California. There are many other programs. Actually, you mentioned low carbon fuel standard and the renewable portfolio standard. Those are actually considered part of AB 32 in getting to the greenhouse gas goals. So let me stop there.
Okay, good, thank you. Thank you. So I'd like to go from electricity to oil and go over to Kathy Rehise Boyd for our report card on AB 32 in the last 10 years.
Well, thank you. And first, is this on? Everyone can hear me? Okay. First of all, thank you for having me, and it's so wonderful to be back in Bakersfield. I've spent quite a few years of my career here, and it's always great to come back and see all the old friends and some of the new ones. So I wish it was under better circumstances. Obviously, the price of crude oil is a very, very difficult situation for our producers right now. Many are being laid off from their jobs and very, very difficult time. But I just wanted to say that for people who are in that situation, very, very difficult time for us. But in this space, we're talking about, I think I want to agree with Todd a little bit on the big conversation that we're having relative to energy and climate change. And it's important relative to California's leadership position because we've been at this for a while, back since 2006. I've certainly been involved since then. But for me, it's really important because California's leadership in this space comes in two forms. And one of those forms is the policy design that they have put together on cap and trade. Why is that important? Because that's the conversation internationally. And we would be remiss in mentioning that there was a very important event that occurred in Paris in December. And that was, who's heard of COP21? Conference of Parties, 21st century, 186 countries getting together to talk about cap and trade, representing 96% of the emissions. Why is that important? Because California is less than 1% of the climate change emissions in the world. And so it's important that we're in that conversation from the design of the policies we're putting in place, because that's what the international community is talking about. But it's also important to talk about what we've learned since 2006. And I think one of those from our perspective is that a market-based system like cap and trade is certainly, or carbon tax, they're both market systems, are the way to go. And things like the low carbon fuel standard, which I'm happy to get into details, some look at that as a complementary policy and some look at that as a contradictory policy. And I can get into the differences of those opinions, and I know many in this room even have differences of those opinions. But what's really important in the climate change space is what we're doing matters from an economic standpoint, and it matters from an environmental standpoint. And I hope we get into the collaborative conversation that the governor calls for to bring parties together to figure out that balance, because it's the economy and the environment that go hand in glove. And I can tell you, I've been doing this way too long, that we make the most environmental improvements when we have a strong economy. And we're working together to figure out that pathway. It's a tough one, as Todd said. It's not easy. It's complicated. But it's important from an environmental standpoint, important from a job standpoint. And all of those things are connected. I always say connect the dots, because that conversation is really important. There's nobody in this room who has the corner on wisdom. Not me, not any one of these panel members. And it's gonna take all of us to figure out this pathway between now and the future where the governor and this state wants to go, in a way that also looks at the vibrancy of the economy. And what that transition looks like is really, really important, so that we don't have a negative impact on the economy while we're trying to meet some pretty aggressive goals for the state of California.
So can I, just to be a little bit more specific on the report card, do you think we're gonna meet the 2020 goals?
Well, I'm not sure whether we're gonna meet them or whether we're gonna surpass them, but I think what the real important conversation is what happens after 2020, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. I mean, 2020 is AB 32, and the conversation that we started having last year was, what does it look like from 2030 on? And in our opinion, we really should spend time on improving the cap and trade system that California has put in place. Others, and as we've said, hooked up with Quebec and others, certainly Mexico is extremely interested, and the rest of the international community is, because that's the really the program of choice from an international perspective. So I think it really matters what the details of those, and we'll get into that, I'm sure, during this hour and a half. But I really would like to say the partnership of all the parties is the only way that we're gonna make this transition work. Because from where we are now and where we need to go is huge. Mm-hmm. It's huge. And for a state of California that has 38 million people who drive 26 million cars, 185 billion miles a year, and we have 155,000 electric vehicles, which is great, and they're increasing, but that is, from a volume standpoint, that is not a small, and you can't do it in 15 years. So those are the details of how we are, where we are, and where we need to go, and then how do we plan that? Those are conversations that the legislature will be having, the Air Resources Board will be having, the stakeholders, whether it's wind or utilities or oil, will be having. And what's really exciting is all you are here to learn about this, and you're taking your time to really understand what that means to you and your families and to the state's economy and to the protection and the environmental stewardship and leadership the state shows. So I just compliment you all for actually coming out and to listen to this conversation.
Thank you. And Senator Fuller, how about you? A report card on AB 32 and our last 10 years of experience with these policies. What are your thoughts?
First, I just need to say that for those of you who don't know, I was born and raised in Bakersfield and actually graduated from Shafter High. I went to Richland Elementary School because the oil industry at that time paid its taxes. And we had an orchestra, and we had a band, and we had a pool, and since my family had not gone to college and I wasn't expected to go to college, I totally credit that support for that community to the industry that brought jobs and money into that community. And I have a PhD now, and I'm a senator. And when my parents brought me home from the hospital, we lived in a rail car in the back of my grandparents' house for the first 3 years. And so I don't like to tell people that. I mostly, Dean knows, because he and I and Fran have been neighbors for years. I don't like to usually talk about that because my parents were sensitive to that, because they did good and things got better. But I need to point that out, because I am a child of the oil boom. I am. And it was a good thing. So how does the report card work? And are we gonna make it? Well, the way I look at it is kind of completely different. It is that Kern County is ground zero for energy production and any changes that hit as a result of AB 32. Yes, businesses and other people are going to be hit, but I don't know if you all know, but 80% of the oil and gas produced in California comes from Kern County. 70% of California's oil and 10% of California's gas. And not only that, but I'm proud that we have a broad portfolio in Kern County. Kern County has online renewable energy projects with the capacity to generate 4,419 megawatts, enough to power 4 million average California homes. And that is substantially more than any other county in this state. And sometimes people in Sacramento don't give us credit for that. They don't realize what the kind of energy that we produce for them. And yet, our state imports two-thirds of our total demand for oil, natural gas, and electricity. Two-thirds. In spite of us doing the heavy lifting in Kern County and having a broad portfolio and working hard to have those jobs and to make them as safe as we can, we import two-thirds of our total energy. That means we are dependent on other states' pricing. We are sending our dollars to other states. Now, if we want our dollars to circulate in our state, we have to have new ones. You know how that is. You can't just at home, you can't just recycle the same ones you had in your savings account. You got to have new money come in. That's what we have to do. So I look at this from my standpoint as what is the report card for our state in both developing safe and reliable energy of all kinds for our state so that we become self-sufficient? And are we tracking, because we're now in the implementation stage, and as a school superintendent, that was important. Once you do the design phase, you can't just wander off. You have to monitor the implementation stage. Are we monitoring the implementation stage and reprogramming the things that would be the most appropriate? No, we are not. There is almost no tracking of this program. There is almost no accountability, and there's almost no transparency for you to go figure it out. So we have some work to do in that area because we need to redesign to continue to make it work. And Kern County is absolutely ground zero. So I say the easy way is just shut off all the imports if we want to get rid of all these energy. Just shut it off. See how it works. I think the governor will be impeached tomorrow. But we could do that and just keep producing what we've got, could we not? So that's obviously not the right choice, but I'm illustrating that it's a complicated problem, and we can meet any report card, but will it yield the results that brings our community, Kern County first and the rest of the state as well, to a better place and a better community? If we're gonna be leaders for the world, let's do it right.
Thank you very much. And Dean Flores, you're brand new to the Air Resources Board, and you wrote an op-ed last year about the difficulty yourself and your vote in favor of AB 32 so encouraging support for SB 350. So what's your thoughts about AB 32 today?
Well, first let me say thank you for hosting this, and it's good to be home, and I'd be remiss to not say it, but welcome my parents. Fran Flores is a city councilwoman, and my dad, who worked for Mobil Chemical for 30 years and retired. So let me first say thanks for both of you for being here. It's not only good to be home, but it's also interesting. I was just at Dagny's going over some notes because I'm sitting between Kathy and Jean, and I've got to go over notes very carefully before that ever happens. And I was sitting at Dagny's, and it was just a funny thing. I was going over my notes, and somebody kind of walked by and glanced at me and then walked by again and glanced again and finally kind of came over with a little courage and said, "Do you know if you had a little more hair and darker brown hair, you'd look just like Dean Flores?" And I go, "I am Dean Flores." So it was interesting. So it's good to be home, let me just, if I could say, I'm glad you brought that up, Dave. I did very early in my career, and I think Gene's correct. You know, anyone who grew up in this area, you know, I lived in Shafter, and to the west we saw the Standard Oil buses going to the oil fields. To the other side, we saw farm workers hitting the fields, going to the west. And so it was interesting to grow up in this very oil-dominated, very job-rich country as a youngster, and all the way through Bakersfield College during my time here. In fact, I think I worked just about every summer at Mobile Chemical, and those graveyard shifts kept me at UCLA, believe me. I wanted to make sure I got through school. But I can say that it was a very critical point in my time in the Senate when AB 32 came up, and it was caught on the floor, and people were kind of figuring out what direction California was going to move, and in some sense, what did our energy future look like? Just very basically a topic of tonight. And you know, of course, you hear the naysayers say, you know, if you vote against that, you're going to be out of office. And then I really kind of thought long and hard about it, but I kind of thought about my daughter about that time, and I thought about what the world might look like for her if we continued on the path that we were heading. And I wanted her to look back, and I wanted her kids to look back and actually ask the question, you know, where was your granddad when one of the biggest pieces of legislation to hit California and the nation was up? And I took a vote for SB 32 at that time, AB 32 at that time. And since I voted for it, of course, I'm going to tell you it was an absolute success. And let me just quantify that for you very quickly. In 2006, when I took that vote, we are now nearing, we'll have 10 million more people in California by the time that report card is due in 2020. And with 10 million more people, you would assume we would never hit that goal. More population, more pollution, we're not going to get there. But I can tell you that what's not talked about very much is in 2002, there was a vote to move renewables to about 20%. And we had to meet that goal by 2017. And do you know we were already there by the time we really began to discuss how we would actually meet in AB 32, the 33% goal? So we had already been moving, and California was already on track to do this. So I was not surprised to watch Governor Brown make a standard of 50% renewables, because I think we're already on that path. I think it's an optimistic path. I think the utilities get it. I think the investment that's coming into California is absolutely mind-boggling. Half the investments and half the jobs in terms of the growing sectors are now here in California. And, you know, of course, the cap and trade, I think, as Kathy said, is very, very complex. It's complex because California has led that effort. We regulate about 600 industries, 600 entities in California. And I'm proud that nearly 100% of them comply. And 100% of them participate. And people are looking at the system and making it work. And I think as we start to think about the outgrowth of the cap and trade, I'm more excited the fact that there's a lot going in terms of those further investments into disadvantaged communities. The Central Valley has a whole host of those. For the first time, I think CARB is actually looking very deeply at the affected census tracts where disadvantaged communities live. And I'm very, very thankful that the pro tem appointed me to this committee, because guess what? They're mostly in the Central Valley. And a lot of those communities are right next and at the pollution center. So yeah, I will also say that part of being on the board is a lot of talk about climate. You know, the climate and Paris and the world and all that, we're only 1%. But I can tell you, for me to be on this board, climate change is just a subset of pollution. Pollution is what we have to continue to focus on and will continue to focus on the board. These other things, and climate change is obviously a very deep, deep issue that we need to solve, but I think the NOx and the SOx and the diesel and the methane and the dairies and the things that we have here in Kern County are still part and parcel of what the Air Board needs to continue to focus on. So I'm very, very happy to be on the board. I want to bring us back to, if you will, in some sense, the total solution, which includes carbon, but also includes good old-fashioned pollution. And when I say I'm home, I should also say I'm home to 52,000 adults in Kern County that have severe asthma. I'm here in Kern County, the home of 22,000 children with severe asthma. I'm here in the home where 17% or 3 out of 5 kids carry an inhaler to school. We have a ton of work to do. on the California Air Resources Board. And I think, has been mentioned, cap and trade is complex. It is necessary. It has been successful. But in terms of the programs we mentioned earlier, the 18 or so many, many programs at the board, it's only my first week, and I can tell you, I wish we had more. I really do. I think giving diversity and choice and markets and things that for industry can come and actually make some choices on what works for them and trying to comply and look at the various programs at the board are all fantastic. Whether you're trying to change your vehicle out for a better, more efficient vehicle, that's a positive. If you're looking to come to the board to try to find a low carbon fuel, a mixture, that's diversity. I mean, in Kern County, we have Crimson Oil, right? We have Crimson Energy. We have Jake Bielan is retired, but we have Kern Oil. You know, we have some fantastic stories here in Kern County of the diversification of moving away from fossil fuel and trying to diversify and give choice to consumers. And at the end of the day, I think that's going to benefit consumers. You know, we have a choppy petroleum industry. It isn't because of cap and trade. It isn't because of the low carbon fuel. It's because we live in a world market. And world outages and things that happen in other countries and things that happen not just here in our borders all affect the ebbs and flows of the employment. We need to diversify to a point where we can even out those ebbs and flows. And I'm very excited to be on a board now that's very, very focused on how to diversify our energy sources. So I'm super, super happy to be on the board. I've got a steep learning curve and a vertical curve that goes straight up. But I can tell you, when I was in the Senate, we passed a whole monumental, a huge amount of bills to make sure that we brought industries into the fold in terms of clean air. I had worked with a lot of folks from the environmental justice community who were absolutely fabulous to make that happen. I'd be remiss if I didn't recognize Tom Franz. Tom, thanks for being here. Been many years. You still have your hair. I don't. But I do. I will say that it's going to take that kind of cooperation. We talk about industry, but we also need to make sure that the environmental community, that the environmental justice community, the disadvantaged communities, the communities that live out in McFarland and Arvin and in Pond and in Button Willow, and I used to tell my colleagues that in the Senate, their eyes would glaze over and wonder what country I'm talking about. But I can say that those communities are the communities that really benefit the most from the kinds of things that CARB does, particularly on the pollution control side, on the short-lived climate issues, on the methane issues. That's what's going to make a difference, and it will absolutely contribute to the carbon issues that CARB is facing as well. So I'm pretty excited to be here. And thanks for telling me what CARB was. I was kind of wondering by the time I got up there, so appreciate that.
We all need to learn that. So I am sensing, I'm not sensing enthusiasm or criticism of AB 32. It sounds like we're still in the middle somewhere.
Don't think we're in the middle of AB 32. I think we're going to surpass that very easily. I think we're going to be successful. Kathy's mentioned the success of cap and trade. I'm going to put a little asterisk on that. I think that we're definitely there on the renewables. The fact that we have some alternatives now, trying to lower our footprint with carbon and fuels is a positive. How we get there, of course, can be debated, but I think we have a whole bunch of tools. I think that AB 32 was a success. There's no doubt about it. Absolute success. And I'm glad that we're moving to 350 because the only way I could remember 350 is that there are 350s in it. And I think if you think about it, all of those goals are absolutely right. You have to be optimistic. No doubt we're in oil country, but just to the east of us is the Tehachapis. Just to the east of us is a whole new generation, a whole new look at renewables, leading, if you will, in the nation in some sense. As much as we'll talk about oil, at some point we'll talk about the wind generation and the Tehachapis and how Kern County transitioned in a very strong and optimistic way to a new economy. And I know that's hard. I know Rockefeller had a tough time with that when we talked about kerosene. And I know Edison pushed really hard to kind of move to electricity. And there was a big battle there. If any of you watch the History Channel, check it out. It's a fascinating documentary on that battle with Rockefeller and J.P. Morgan and Edison. But you know, that was a tough transition as well. It's always tough when you're transitioning to the new economy. So I would say that we just have to kind of stay focused and be optimistic. And as Kathy said, work together to try to all get there.
Good. Okay, I just want to make sure we had a clear report card. Yes, sir, what's good or not. And Paul, your perspective on AB 32 and how what What it's done for
California.
Well,
let me first say it's. I'm happy to see that Dean's on this panel. I'm happy to see that Dean was appointed to CARB. It's good to know that somebody who's concerned about air quality in the valley is at CARB, because this panel, when we first was proposed, air quality in the valley was not part of the topic of discussion, and it's now a part of the discussion. And because Dean is here, it's a focus of this discussion, and I think we should keep it there. You asked me to give a report card on SB 32. I give it an F. I give it an F because it's a target that was built on hype. It's unambitious. At the same time, it will easily be surpassed. It'll be surpassed because of the way that we count renewable energy in the targets. So yes, we're going to surpass the targets, but it was unambitious. So let me give you a sense of scale. Today in California, new renewables only account for 14% of in-state generation. Total renewables, so that includes all our old hydro plants, brings us up to a whopping 20% after 10 years. And a fair portion of that was built 30 years ago. We're just now getting to where we should have been 30 years ago. Denmark today gets 50% of its electricity today from renewable energy. Italy gets one-third of its electricity from renewable energy in country, not buying it from Germany. Germany gets 33% of its electricity from in-state resources, again, not buying it from France or Denmark. And Spain gets 33% of its electricity from renewables today. Now, if you want to talk about ambitious targets, it's not 50%, particularly the way we count renewables, which we can buy from anywhere, Mexico or Canada or Wyoming. If we want to talk about ambitious targets, let's consider what Scotland proposes by 2020 to be 100% renewable in electricity. Denmark proposes that by 2020, 50% of its electricity will be from wind energy alone, so that doesn't include the other renewables, 100% in electricity and heat, and in Denmark they do use heat by 2020, and 100% of electricity and heat and transportation, that means they have to eliminate oil in transportation by 2050. In Germany, their target is 50% in electricity by 2030 and 80% in electricity by 2050. Those are in-state resources. They're not buying them from somebody else. Those are ambitious targets. And most of the analysts today, when they're looking at renewable energy targets, they're not even talking about 100% anymore. We're talking about 200% renewable energy, 300% renewable energy, because we not only have to meet renewable energy in electricity, but in heat for our buildings and cooling for our homes here in Bakersfield, but also in transportation. If we're going to offload passenger vehicles, electric vehicles, we're going to need a lot more electricity. So people are looking to the future today are not talking about 50% renewable energy and electricity. They're talking about 100%, 200%, or 300%. Now, if you had those kind of targets, I would give you an A for ambition.
Thank you. So I want to ask one question about fuel and then another one about renewables. So we'll come back to this topic. But I want to ask first about fuels and start with you again, Kathy Rehise Boyd. Just the governor's goal of 50% reduction by 2030, could we do that? And if not, you know, what do you see the going forward, how our fuel consumption will, what's the projection? What's your forecast?
Yeah, let's just to follow up a little bit on what Paul said, you need to put that in context of what are the energy demands in this country, right? By 2040, it's not that long away, 80% of the demand is still supplied by coal, gas, and oil. And so you can put ambitious targets on the table, and targets that are ambitious are fine as targets, but they can't be done in the context of ignoring facts. They have to be part of that conversation when we talk about how where we are and where we're going. It's great that wind and solar have quadrupled but they are still a small percentage. It is not as if we can start tomorrow and completely turn over the entire transportation system in that aggressive a time frame. So I keep going back to, it's not that everybody doesn't want to make sure we can reach these goals as we go forward, but it's the how, it's the what, it's the cost, it's the timing, and all those things are really, really important, because I guarantee you, every one of us in this room does three things when we wake up every day. We expect to turn our lights on, we expect to heat and cool our homes, and we expect to drive from A to B affordably and reliably. Now that can look like a really different mix in the future, but there is an issue of where we are and where we're going and how we make that bridge. Diversification is wonderful. Nobody puts, even in their own stock portfolios, puts all their eggs in one basket, right? Diversification is key. But it is in the context of facts and where we are, and those cannot be ignored. So, you know, can we reach these goals again? I don't know. But is everybody trying to reach these goals in a way that does not impact jobs in the economy, so that environment and the economy are hand in glove? I will guarantee we cannot get there without one or the other. They have to be both, and that conversation has to be both. And it's in the context of, you know, employment. It's jobs and employment. So it's wonderful to have ambitious goals. I appreciate that. But I also appreciate the reality of the situation and where we are and where we're going and what it takes to make that happen. So I think in the area of fuel diversification, in the area of electricity, which I'm sure Todd can talk a lot about relative to how one can transform the electricity side of the equation. But I also want to talk about the cost of that to the consumer. Let's not forget that these programs and policies, all meritorious, have an impact to the consumer as well. And when you look at cap and trade, which now deals with all emissions from fuels are under the cap, so all the emissions from fuels from cars are within the cap and trade. The impact, according to the California Energy Commission and the Air Resources Board, is 10 to 12 cents a gallon. Okay, that's a price signal. But if California is the only one that's doing it, all we're doing is increasing the cost of fuel for 1% of the climate change emissions. People outside of California probably think that's wonderful, because they're not incurring those costs. So that's why that conversation is a bigger one. That's why everybody has to be in the conversation. It can't just be California. It's not a leader if no one's following you. Now we're getting people linking, and that's good, that's great. But that needs to expand if we're not going to be the only ones incurring that cost, because the consumers are incurring it. Low carbon fuel standards at the very low end of that program, without even talking about what that even means, it's 4.3 cents a gallon. We pay the highest gasoline taxes in the entire United States except for Hawaii. 60 to 70 cents more. Why? Because we've got a great clean burning, you know, fuel. We make the cleanest burning gasoline and diesel on the planet, and that was a joint effort with the Air Resources Board and our industry and the automakers. So, you know, we've done a lot of things to help in this transition, but there is a cost with it, and how that impacts the consumer as we transition is a really, really important conversation, especially relative to the jobs that are needed in the Central Valley, in the Inland Empire, that don't benefit from some of the coastal regions who don't have high unemployment. You know, it'd be great if everybody could, you know, drive a Tesla. They're rather expensive still. We've got great technologies on coming out on hybrids and even on the zero emission vehicle side. But it takes a lot of subsidy, $125 million for 59,000 cars in 2012.
So, the state is moving aggressively to reduce our fuel consumption. I mean, will it reduce, or what's your expectation
going? Here's an outcome, an unintended consequence of reducing fuel consumption, right? Our entire state infrastructure is built on the gas tax, okay? We haven't figured out yet what's going to happen when we're starting to have less consumption. We already know where the gas tax is going, in the tank. We're $300 billion, as Senator Fuller well knows, $300 billion in the hole in this state on infrastructure. So if it's not going to come from the gas tax, I'm on a commission right now, appointed by the legislature, to talk about where is it going to come from. Are we going to tax electric vehicles? Is there going to be some other, you know, avenue?
Mm-hmm. Good, thank you. Dean Flores, what's your thought about the looking ahead at fuel consumption and...
Yeah, I don't know where to start, my friend Kathy. I think that's, the consumer is, has to have more choice. And I'm a market guy, so I think, when the consumer has some more choices beyond gas, then I think we'll be able to actually do that. So let me just give you, we're talking about 10 cents, 5 cents, 6 cents more, 8 cents more. How about a dollar less for gas, in some sense, right? Or that's our framework. But I think, how about a dollar less for the same mile traveled? We want to move to electric vehicles. And it doesn't have to be a Tesla. You know, there was a time there was 7 models, now there's 70. And let me just kind of give an example of this. So you want to really, so energy costs are about, for the equivalent from a mile traveled, about a dollar less if you're getting an electric vehicle. And I get the skepticism, but let me just point out a little side note. I like history. So if you think about battery cars, electricity, the state of technology, where we are with batteries now, the cost of it going down substantially. I always like to point to a study. There was a study by Ma Bell. We remember Ma Bell from the old days. In 1980, they said, 1980s when the first cell phones came out, they asked the question to a very reputable McKinsey company, what's the cell phone market going to look like in 2000? This is now when I was in high school, and they're looking 20 years forward. McKinsey came back, a very reputable firm, and said, by the year 2000, in terms of cell phones, given the clunkiness and the battery and the lack of them, kind of like we're talking about cars now, there'll be 900,000 cell phones in the year 2000, just 1980. Well, 2000 hit, and we sold 900,000 first day. And the second day, we sold another 900,000, and then we sold 120 million. And right now we have 8 billion lines, 20 years from the time that study was asked. And I use that because why did that occur? Why did this disruption occur? And it wasn't because people looked out and said, too clunky, battery life won't go that far, won't work. It was the fact that we innovated towards a better battery. It became, for the consumer, a cheaper alternative. Anybody want to turn a landline on lately? Compared to your cell bill. And then we also found the fact that communities who didn't even have that took a huge leap. Absolutely a huge leap. I mean, there were communities today in the world that actually took a leap from the landline that didn't even have the capability to a cell phone. So I am very optimistic, when we look back 20 years from now, as they did there in 1980, McKinsey company saying 900,000, I have no doubt that we're going to burst past 1.5 million electric vehicles very quickly. Our society tells us that. Our consumers choose that. But you have got to give them the choice. And I'll tell you, consumers are going to pick a dollar less in mile traveled on electric than they are a dollar or 8 cents or 6 cents, whatever we're arguing about today, for petroleum. It's going to be a mixture. And it's going to happen very rapidly. It's going to happen very quickly. And Elon Musk is going to look like in the dust by the time the rest of the automakers start to kind of move in this direction. And that's already occurring, as you know.
Mm-hmm. So do you see a 50% fuel reduction by 2030 as realistic? Or
I do. I mean, but it has to have the mix of the things I've mentioned. You have to have, so Obama's new fuel efficiency regs go in effect. You have to put communities closer, a little bit closer to each other. I think we're starting to do that. We're getting wise on that now. And we also have to kind of find the right mix for electric vehicles, alternative fuel vehicles. When you do all of that, I believe it's 4%, 17%, and another 10% on the factors I've just mentioned. You've already hit just about that number. Mm-hmm. And that's facts. That's not me kind of throwing it out. That's just kind of what it is. But I think what we're missing is the fact that the state of electric vehicles today is no similar than we were with cell phones in 1980 when we were talking literally about the convenience and something of using something of that sort. That's a technology that's going to move very, very quickly, is my view.
Senator Fuller, your thoughts about the governor's goal of a 50% fuel reduction in 2030?
Well, I think it's very simple. I think we can hit the 50% goal with ease. The problem is what human behavioral changes do we want to make in our society? And how much do we want to pay for it? And you cannot hit these goals without huge human behavioral changes. Just from as simple as if you're going to save electricity in your house, you have to turn off the lights all the time. Now, yes, you can get technology that turns the lights off for you if you have enough money to buy the gadget and if it's developed, technologically developed. So you have to go back to, does our state want to be the ones that forces in a socialistic way behavioral changes on people, or do we want to let the market and the technology that we are very, very good at, innovation, drive the change at its pace? There's a fundamental problem that we're all disregarding when it comes to looking through people's eyes and saying, okay, I do like certain kinds of energy better than other kinds, but there's high heat energy and there's low heat energy. And all of you that know about fuels know that high heat energy fuels are things that drive trucks and carry big, heavy loads. And low heat are generally things like lights, and somewhere in between there is the electric car, right? Okay, and the low heat ones, probably we can change to sooner, but the high heat ones we don't have a good replacement for, and it's very expensive, and other states are going to be ahead of us. So how are we gonna truck our groceries? How are we gonna truck our ag? For our region, the human behavioral changes are very, very tough changes. Very, very tough on our economy, very, very tough on us. We have long ranges, and the technology is not there. The battery technology is not there. But San Francisco, honestly, it's far easier for them. They could hit it sooner. Because if you look at the way they do stuff, they have a harbor right next door. They don't have to truck stuff long distances. And they can use electric cars, and most people don't even have a car in San Francisco. They rent one when they have to go somewhere. And there's a whole tighter pattern. So for me, it's really about, as a legislator, it's easy for bureaucrats to sit and decide all the stuff that's coming, and it's exciting, and it's kind of wishful thinking. What type of behavioral changes are you forcing on people by their region? And our region is going to be hit the hardest, so we have to speak up the most. So if you go back and you look at, would we tolerate rationing of high heat intensity fuels? Would we? Wouldn't bother some people at all. In San Francisco, probably doesn't matter that much. But here, almost everybody in the economy would be affected. Would we be able to drive electric cars on a regular basis to our work and to our places? Well, I commute to Sacramento every single Sunday and every single Thursday, by the way. And I cannot do it in the current electric cars. And it would cost us twice as much. I calculated out that if we were to go to the electric cars tomorrow to get the same cost, everybody would have to buy twice as many cars for twice as much if we did it tomorrow. Can we do it? Yes, we can. Do we want to force these kind of changes on people? That is the bigger question. So for me, I think we need to look at it a more regional. I'm really glad to work with Dina on certain projects, like, you know, the sludge project. I'm forever grateful that you started helping us get rid of the sludge from LA, and we're still fighting that. We haven't won that, but you were certainly a champion in that. Because that solution was an LA solution, not a Central Valley solution. And that is the same problem that we are having here today. So, can we hit it? Some people will hit it with very little pain. Our area will hit it with a great deal of pain, And oh, by the way, I haven't even gotten to, but I know it's, I need to make it short. I haven't even gotten to the middle class is leaving because they can't afford to work here, and the workers' replacement is really, really hard. And why can't they? Because these costs are going up exponentially, especially in places like this. And not only that, but CEQA needs to be reformed. CEQA has many good things that it's helped us, but the refusal to modify it in the face of the changes they're asking us to make is ridiculous.
Thank you. So, Todd, I want to get to renewables about that provision, but also I'm sure you're involved in the electrification of cars, and SB 350, if I'm right, called on the utilities to put charging stations all over the state to lead towards more electric cars, correct?
It described it as infrastructure, but I think, you know, we started out talking about where we've been with AB 32. And we kind of, it feels like we're stuck here in the panel now as we try to go forward. So let me offer something else. Let's leap ahead to 2050, when we're looking to get goals of massive carbon reduction, 80% less than 1990 levels. What will it take? That is the challenge. And we're kind of stuck thinking about that. You may have heard the term, let's walk out here, inflection point. Inflection point is when there's no speed and no acceleration. That's not what we have in California. What do we have? Tremendous acceleration. Things are coming faster and faster. And so our challenge is, how do we get there? How do we get there at reasonable cost? 2 points. Self-sufficiency. California has never been self-sufficient on electricity. And our renewables targets, we in California have greatly benefited from federal tax credits and from Chinese industrial subsidies for solar PV. And our customers are great beneficiaries of that. And that's been good for California. And we continue to lead the way in California. Now look out, I see many customers. Who here is a PG&E customer? Raise your hand if you're a PG&E customer, okay? Feels like a lot of them. Who here has solar panel on your roof? Raise your hand if you have solar panels on your roof. 1, 2, 3, 4, more than a dozen people here, okay? Kern County also has our customers, about half of them, on low-income subsidized rates. And one of the challenges is thinking about, we want to promote solar panels, we want to promote renewable energy, and we got to make it affordable for the massive amounts of folks, half our customers in Kern County, who are on subsidized rates. And there's a real challenge to balance that, to get those environmental goals, to keep the cost reasonable, and to keep the electric system safe and reliable. But we can get there, and it's accelerating. And PG is confident, working with the rest of the state, working with parties, working with industry, government, that this can be done. And California has a history of doing that. So I think we need to look up, jump, leap ahead to 2050, and then work backwards.
Good. I'm going to come back to in a minute, but Paul, what's your thought?
Well, I wanted to go to what Kathy said earlier about reality and about how we're going to deal with so much coal in our generation mix. Well, let me just point out to Kathy, she may not be aware of this, that Ontario, Canada closed all its coal-fired power plants, 25% of their supply within 10 years. And Ontario is the industrial heart of Canada. They made a policy decision to close their coal plants. A party ran on that platform. They won, and unlike a lot of politicians, they actually delivered on their campaign promises and closed those coal plants ahead of schedule within 10 years. And going back to the laudatory description of our cap and trade program, there is another mechanism for limiting carbon emissions, and that's a carbon tax. And you mentioned Quebec, but let me point out to you that in Alberta, Canada, they are proposing a carbon tax. And for those of you who don't know, in Alberta, they call Texas the Alberta of the South. And that's a province that has been conservatively ruled for almost 50 years. And that government that's recently been elected there has proposed to close, yes, all its coal-fired power plants. Alberta. That shows you when you have the political will, you can do things. And so we need the political will, and I want to follow up with what Todd said, and also Dean. That what's happening with electric vehicles is happening both because the technology is advancing at a very rapid pace. As Todd mentioned, when we look for these things are coming much, much faster than even people like myself, who's an advocate of electric vehicles, of wind and solar panels, for example. They're happening faster than I can estimate. When I started my career, I was saying if we ever got wind energy to 10% of supply, wow, that would be terrific. We probably can't go more than 10%. Within 10 years in my career, I said 20%. We could never do more than 20%. The world would come to an end beyond 20%. Then we reached 30%. We said, well, maybe 50% is okay. And then we're approached. We've got 50%. So now we say we can do so much more. Part of our limitation is our limitation of vision of what we can and cannot do. And unfortunately, we in America and here in California have fallen back in backbiting and political discourse that doesn't advance us to where we really need to go. If we're going to address clean air issues in this valley, if we're going to meet our climate change targets, because they are important, whether we're 1% of the supply of carbon emissions in the world or not, we have to do it if we want to be leaders or if we want to be followers. That's a choice we can all make, of course. And I would say that of the people here, I know four people who drove to this event in electric cars. That's four people in Bakersfield who drove here in electric car in 2016. I didn't think that was going to happen, but here we are. And one of the things that's going to make electric cars successful is just drive one. It's fun. It puts fun back in driving. Turn off that eco mode and put your pedal to the metal and you will go. And that's what's going to sell electric cars.
Thank you. So Todd, I did want to come back to the 50% goal, and that it is now law. We're going to have to adopt it by 2030, and what that means. You know, and I want to follow up on a theme that we're going towards here, you know, just the rapid change. And I was going to get to, I want to get questions to the audience pretty soon, but how does that rapid change look to average people? You know, what does it mean in terms of cost? What does it mean in terms of my lifestyle? You know, but if you could speak to that in terms of what it means for the 50% renewables too.
Sure. And so right now, PG&E is able to provide our customers with electricity 30% renewable. We'll be well on target to get past 33% by 2020. We'll probably be about 37% current projection. 50% by 2030 looks real challenging, but looks doable. As long as we don't say exactly how we have to get there today, as long as we can just along the way, as long as we can learn. 10 years ago, solar photovoltaic panels, no way would they be a significant part of the mix. They just seemed too expensive. Cost of about 1/4 now of the projections from 10 years ago. And so if I had to say today what the mix would be in 2030, that's a losing proposition. We need to adjust along the way. We need to think about wider integration regionally. We need to think about interesting breakthroughs in storage technologies to enable more renewables. I appreciate you mentioned Denmark, Paul. Of course, they rely greatly on the hydro in Scandinavia to work, mm-hmm. and Germany relies on France and Poland to help integrate their renewables. In California, we rely—
Well, the Germans do export electricity to France, that is correct.
And so in California, we rely on a variety of storage technologies. We're looking, state law, California policy, to transform the energy storage market. And if we get transformation there, the way we've gotten in solar PV breakthroughs in cost, it may cost far less than the projections. But we don't know, and we need to take it a step at a time. One thing I can tell you for sure, California policy is going to change. Because if you look to see, since 2002, Dean, every 2 years the legislature's passed additional renewable laws. And Gene.
But I wasn't one of them, by the way.
I appreciate that. I look to see what the laws were going to be in 2018 or 2024. The one thing I know is they'll be different from what they are today. So our target, even for 2030, is likely to adjust along the way. And if it costs too much, we need to think about a different way to get those greenhouse gas reductions. And if it doesn't cost as much as we think, or it looks like there's some real breakthroughs, we should pedal to the metal there.
Thank you.
I love my friends at the utility. They have a guaranteed rate of return. We are not that. If we were that, we wouldn't be laying off people at $30 a barrel. Okay, so it is an interesting conversation relative to the utilities versus how others have to deal with these issues in the state. Mm-hmm. And I would say to my friend Paul, now I know why we're at different sides of the table.
Yeah, it's getting hard.
For one, I'm so happy to hear that Paul supports the renaissance of natural gas so that we can have the cleanest burning fossil fuel to deal with our electricity, which California has done from the beginning of time. So it's great to hear that we support that. And for our industry, we have no issue with carbon tax or cap and trade. For those in the audience, there are two mechanisms that do the same thing. They are both market mechanisms. And whether you pick one or the other, my association's actually split. Half of my members like carbon tax and half of my members like cap and trade. California picked cap and trade, so we're in that one. But the carbon tax up in Canada is actually very, very successful. It's very transparent, sends a direct price signal. It's not complicated. Cap and trade's complicated, and it's not as transparent. Mm-hmm. But they both achieve the same things. Carbon tax, you know the price. You're not quite sure about the emission reductions you get. Cap and trade, you know the emission reductions, and you're not quite sure of the cost. So actually, you know, Paul, we actually agree on a couple things.
Yeah, it's good. Great. Senator Fuller, I'd like to ask you,
I would point out that electric vehicles are far quieter than gassers.
You obviously don't like NASCAR.
Senator Fuller, when we're talking about rapid change through these policies, how do you think that looks in Bakersfield? What does it mean for people in Bakersfield?
Well, I think that's a really good question. Let me just start out and say, okay, my job when I first started teaching was the technology director, and I had more fun calling all the companies of all the places and getting innovation and bringing it to the schools before it was cost effective for us ever to buy it, and because companies were willing to donate it. And I was the one that figured out how to make it run when nobody else could because there wasn't a manual, and I love that. So let's just don't get into the Gene Fuller is like against change and never think it's going to happen, because if you look at my history, you are going to find yourself in very shaky ground. My whole point tonight really is that as an administrator, I had a finite pot of money that I wanted to use for the best value for my children. I wanted them to have what every other kid in every other district and all those other cities that could afford to have really rich people give them donations and grants for computers and things. I wanted my kids to have that. So in order to do that, I had to pinch the pennies, I had to ask parents to help, and I had to figure out how we got donations and how we get there. I haven't changed at all. All of you that know me know that my biggest problem is I don't have a good filter, because I will just tell you what I think the common sense solution is. And I will tell you that honestly, no matter how many times you talk to me. But I will research it to the end, because I love being a scholar. So what do I think about technology? I think the market is going to drive the most exciting technology ever. And I wish I could live another 100 years so I could see it. But my experience in politics has made me find that politics is often driven by winners and losers being created by people who want to make money off the system. And that people in areas who maybe don't have the numbers suffer. And I just think that, like, hey, you're going to see me driving a hybrid. I probably do and don't even know it right now. I mean, you know, these things, it's incredible what the cars they're making these days. And you are going to see all of us changing. But this stupid debate, and I sort of go back to what you said in the beginning, the stupid debate over are we making our goals or not, and is it important or not, it really doesn't matter. Like France, Yeah, they're making goals. And just because we love their people and the way they dress and their food, like, do we think that they should lead in technology? And oh, by the way, a big part of their portfolio is nuclear. Like, more than renewables is nuclear. They count it as renewable. I don't think that's a solution that's going to work for us. Even though maybe I would think it was okay. It's not gonna happen. And Australia, they have the biggest coal and gas mines in the world. And they count hydroelectricity. The we don't count, and it's clean, you know. That means water that comes out of a dam and makes electricity, it's clean. And we've already built it, and they count that. So back to, are we gonna make our goals? Well, humans are making up these goals, and some of them are just stupid, and some of them are rewarding other people. And at the end of the day, some of them are good, and we need to evaluate those all along the way as a community and decide how we can make it work for us. And how we make those choices in America is by having the market drive it and having the cost drive it. Now, I get so mad when I sit in these committees. They go, well, we're gonna send a price signal out to everybody so they will quit whatever bad behavior we think is bad this week because somebody's gonna make money off of it. I hear that every single day up there. And I'm an educator and it kills me. It kills me. But we have to make those choices based on the market. We have to support the market, and as long as we do that and as long as people can bring the market down, it'll work. Now, there's a whole bunch of technological problems that we have to fix. And going back to your question, and I'm gonna be done, sorry. I told my husband before I left, I promised him I was not gonna get overly involved in this, and I was not gonna vent, and I was not gonna say what I really thought, because somebody would probably shoot me, because I was born here, and I am, like, you know, educated from BC, and, you know, I just can't help it. But technology, like the grid, isn't a huge problem. I love electricity, and I'm gonna use electricity, and I probably have a hybrid car. If you check me out, I probably do. I just don't know. I'm not really not sure.
We'll take a look.
All right, because now the gas models go so efficiently, how would you know what it was? And I don't care. I just look at how much I get mile per hour, you know, because I'm driving back and forth to Sacramento, and I'd go broke on the salary trying to drive back and forth if I didn't look at those things. But the grid is in huge trouble. The grid has to be completely overhauled in order for it to really work well for us. And we're going to do it, and I think we'll get there. But if they said tomorrow that we have to go completely on electricity from the grid, most of us would have to move out of state. We already have our residential electric price is already about 1.5 times higher than other competing states, all the other competing states. So the grid has to become interactive. That's how it has to become, okay? And right now, you know, it's like the big flow that pushes everything through. But because we have rooftop solar and all those other things now, it has to be interactive. It has to know how much to send here and how much to send here and not have to keep the whole thing full all the time. Okay, so that's a problem. We gotta fix. Then there's this whole thing. If you're gonna electrify the train, the high-speed rail train, you gotta put like electricity all the way down the valley, big electricity, and something's gotta feed it, electricity. That's this grid. Well, we haven't solved that problem yet either, but we're building the train, so it's not gonna be electrified yet. So, okay, we'll get there. But how much is it gonna cost, because we're forcing this to happen through a bureaucratic rule that somebody came up with just because they thought it was a good idea that day, or some friend of theirs got some money, instead of the market actually having a good business plan that does it. And I could go on and on and on, and that's the crux of technology. Yes. We are way farther ahead than we ever thought we would be in many areas, and California will continue to do that because we're awesome, and because our university system is good, and because I worked hard to educate all of our children. But
thank you.
I'm not sure if we are using the right means to get the technology to the place.
Thank you. So, Dean, I just wanted to, before I go to the audience, just to come back to what. We're looking at this rapid change. We're going through a transition economically, lifestyle-wise. What does that look like to people? What should they be looking for? How is this going to affect them?
You mean in terms of the, your question again?
Just looking at this rapid change that we're seeing in terms of renewables, in terms of electrification, and the economic changes, the lifestyle changes, how would you describe how to somebody in California, how their lives are going to change, what does it mean for them?
That's a good question. Since you're going to be doing audience questions, and we're in Bakersfield, could I speak all the way to the ends? Is that possible? I'm kidding. Joking.
Good try.
Very opinionated, folks. No, I actually think, you know, obviously our lives have changed very much since technology does that, right? So whether you've got a cell phone in your pocket today that actually has more capability, I think, than the lunar module landed on the moon, I think that's the correct deal. Things change very quickly and in bounds, and I think in 20 years it's very difficult for us to kind of look forward. Our lives have already changed, and I think we're already feeling the effects in some sense of what's to come. But I think as we've let's use renewables for a moment. You know, did anybody know here when you turn your light on that PG&E had already hit 33% renewables? Okay, so you know, I think we're going to transition into the new energy frontier very seamlessly for consumers. And I think if you think about it, we're not going to see it by the time we turn the light on. It's just going to actually happen in some sense. In the background, I will say that consumers, part of the reaching our goals, particularly on the carbon side and on the climate side, is that we do have to change our habits. I think Senator Fuller said it correctly. I think there's an issue of what we do. There's efficiencies. Those are important, you know, and I think that there's also behavior. That's important. And then I think there's technology, and that also helps us kind of move this forward. I will say that we're always going to have goals. I mean, we're in Bakersfield, home of the Bakersfield Drillers. Kevin McCarthy, my good friend, who is our leader in Congress, is a graduate from Bakersfield High School. How boring, and Bakersfield High School is football because of Frank Gifford, but if you think about how boring a football game would be if we just stopped on the 20-yard line. You know, we continually move the goal. We continually move the flags. We continually move the post because at some point, we have a goal of reaching something that is going to be absolutely wonderful, to use Donald Trump, beautiful. It's going to work beautifully. Trust me. But seriously, it's we're moving these goals, and people get very nervous about them. And I understand the need to have some sense that we have to finish one goal before we move to the other. But we're rapidly reaching these goals so quickly that we continually need to move the goals. When the governor moved the goal in state of state in 2015 and said we need to be at 50% renewables, we need to be at 50% petroleum reduction, you know, it's as though, and then it was codified in Senator De Leon's bill 350, it was almost as though, you know, the world was going to end. I felt that when we did AB 32. I wrote about this because I felt like we were at that same point. And I guarantee you, as we continue to move the goal lines to the touchdown, the score is really a place where everybody's energy is lower, their efficiency is better, their lives are better, more importantly, their health is better. The health issues we have not talked about in terms of all of these changes, you know, $80 billion worth, the American Lung Association says, plus of health benefits when we move to these changes. You know, that saves a lot of work time, it saves a lot of premature deaths, saves a lot of heart attacks. You know, the end result of pollution is always in making pollution, kind of eliminating that with better fuels and better methods is actually going to be a real big positive. I think one of the things we're going to see, hopefully, when we're done with this from an average everyday person is a much more healthier place to live. And given that we're in Kern County, I think that's super, super important, given our asthma rates, given where we're at. I will say that one of the things that all the panelists agree on, and I think Gene's hit, is it is a transition. It seems bumpy, but I think in the way that we leap now in technology, it happens very rapidly. You know, as I mentioned, you know, Edison created the grid 100 years ago. It's made for one thing: is to send energy out. Okay, we have a grid today that wants energy to come in, and out, and communicate, and send back, and we have smart meters, PG&E. We have all of these things that now are making our grid more efficient, but that really wasn't what it was made for. So it's going to be a little choppy. It's going to be a little different. The grid wasn't created 100 years ago to do what we want it to do today. All of these changes, I think, will take some sense of particularly the CARB is really kind of be working to try to make those, you know, more of a plus and a more of a seamless way for consumers.
think I heard something. I just want to make sure, Dean.
Yeah.
I thought I heard you say smart meters make our grid more efficient.
I said that.
So I appreciate that. So thank you, Dean.
You can put that on a frame.
All right.
Good. Well, I really do want to get some questions from the audience. And we have a microphone over here. So if there are questions, please, if you give your name and if you have an affiliation you could share with us, that would be appreciated. So any questions from the audience? Right here.
Hi, I'm David Wolf, and we're coming up into summertime. Two summers ago, we had a number of brownouts. Seems like last summer we didn't have that problem. You've mentioned the grid. We've mentioned electrical. What's this summer looking like for short term, just out of curiosity?
Take it. That's for Todd.
I was thinking Todd, but sure. Gene also mentioned the grid. So either one, anybody?
Actually, our summer forecast usually comes out around May after the hydro precipitation season kind of ends. Early March, a little bit too soon, but I do note that it really helps the El Nino year. Unfortunately, it hasn't been quite as wet as some people had forecasted, but still hydro is a little bit better than average and typical, and that goes a long way towards keeping energy costs lower in terms of capacity and having meeting peak capacity. A lot of renewables coming online. So actually, it turns out, like at noon in the summer, there's likely to be an excess of electricity on the grid. Okay. And you know, it's known as the duck chart. I have you can get an app from the California Independent System Operator called ISO Today, and you can see in the middle of the day, actually, there's plenty of electricity. Even, you know, it's a little bit later in the day, around 6, 7, 8 p.m. in the summer, when you still have lots of air conditioning and lots of load. People go home, turn on their lights, and then, you know, the sun isn't quite so strong then, and the wind may not have picked up. So actually, that tends to be the challenge, less so than just simply meeting the peak load, which is a bit earlier in the day. And so to see what that duck chart will look like for the summer, I don't know quite yet. Let's check back in another month or two.
Good, thank you.
I'd love to comment on that briefly. There are spots around the state that are in worse shape than others. So to ask one company doesn't give you the whole picture. So the nuclear plant that was shut down on the in San Diego, just outside of San Diego, maybe some of you don't know, caused a problem because there's a chokehold in the distribution system on the grid that goes to San Diego. And so now they are trying to figure out how they're going to make sure they don't have brownouts throughout Los Angeles from the Aliso Canyon gas leak. Yeah. And they also have a chokehold that they're trying to figure out how they can put enough electricity to San Diego to stop brownouts, because these are uncontrollable brownouts. Some of our brownouts, you know, in Bakersfield, they were kind of controllable because other people were getting off, were paid to get off the grid if you went into a brownout, so eventually you get it back up. But these are no technological solution to them, and they're sort of ongoing. So if you are in LA, the truth is that if Aliso Canyon doesn't, there's no technological solution yet developed that will make this work in a timely way. But if that doesn't work, there are going to be brownouts in LA. Now, you can put up peaker plants and other things.
Gene, I heard you say basically Bakersfield will be better off this summer than LA in terms of having electricity.
Yes, so that's
all right.
Right. And peaker plants can help, but peaker plants are fossil fuel in most cases.
Yes.
And a lot of communities don't want them. In San Diego, they voted against the old peaker plants that they mothballed, putting them back in to get them through the time. So they just don't have a solution because it's a kind of a political problem as well as a chokehold. In Aliso Canyon, it's because there's high pressure gas. Which is not the oil companies at all. This is a whole nother deal. High pressure gas storage being put in there, and they have no way to like cap it off without it having other problems start out. So it is an old grid. It is an old highway system. It is an old dam system. This is California. We have ridden on the backs of our wonderful World War II parents who made America better and were willing to give to fix those kind of infrastructure programs. Now we got to figure it out. We do have
Thank
new
you.
Technology, but around the state, if you move, It's going to be harder.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, Gene, that San Diego is not interested in peaker plants. And I think it's important for people of Bakersfield to understand that San Diego passed a climate action plan. Now, San Diego, that's a Republican council, it's a Republican mayor. They unanimously passed a climate action plan that included moving to 100% renewable energy. And in San Diego, that wasn't buying renewable energy from Wyoming, that was making renewable energy in their own community that they would own themselves. And while we're at it, Lancaster. Now, San Diego's a rather wealthy community, we all know that, and Bakersfield's not quite as wealthy as San Diego, though, of course, we have good quality of life here, too. Lancaster, California, Republican City Council, Republican Mayor, Rex Paris is quite an impressive political figure in California. I think we're going to see more of him. They have a policy of net zero by 2020. That is, they will produce all of their own electricity by 2020 with renewables in their community that they own. And that's what San Diego could do to avoid that problem that Southern California Edison, not our friends at PG&E, Southern California Edison caused by this mismanagement of a nuclear power plant that they are trying to put the cost of their disastrous management on the ratepayers of California through our corrupt Public Utility Commission. So I hope Gene can take some action on that with Governor Brown.
Well, and I have to say that local control, though, is the key.
Yeah.
That's the key. What communities can do and what they want to change their behaviors, that's how we have to get there.
Thank you. Let's get to another question. We have another question over here.
Hi, name's Mike Warren. One thing you don't hear much about is CO2 capture and storage. I wonder if perhaps Dean could comment on that. From the little bit of research I've done, it does seem like there's definitely some cost hurdles, but I'm just wondering if those were overcome, could it be a material help?
I'll chime into that.
Okay, I'm not sure I don't want Kathy to go first on that, but
either one of you.
But I'll start. You know, in terms of carbon capture, I mean, I think it is obviously as we watch some of the debate among the Supreme Court and its kind of stay of the Obama clean energy, or what is it, CCA? What is the term, clean?
The clean power plant.
Power plant.
Power
Sorry,
plant.
Thank you, Kathy. You know, I think we watch these debates over the capture versus kind of going the other way, right? Kind of carbon free. I think it is something that continues to need discussion. I think California, it probably is not, my guess is not moving in a direction of just trying to have these capture types of things. I think we really like to move to better types of alternatives and technologies. I don't know. I mean, when I think of carbon, I always think of like things that people don't think about, maybe like the sea. It actually is, you know, what, 95% or so of kind of the carbon in the world. There are things that we still have to learn, but I would probably say that my view of it is that carbon capture is probably not high on my agenda, at least. Kathy?
So I think it's a remarkably wonderful technology. We spent, as assigned by the governor and legislature, we were put on a blue ribbon committee to study this, and we did, and everyone was on this, including our friends at NRDC and the environmental community. We came up with an agreement on how wonderful this technology could be for a transitionary period, because we are taking carbon from entering the atmosphere and we're putting it underground and putting it to beneficial use, so that the carbon stays underground and we can have a tradition, you know, a sort of a pathway forward. It's stated in the scoping plan of AB 32 as a technology. The Air Resources Board is now holding workshops on this very point. And the concern that the Air Resources Board has and wants to make sure they, and we agree with, is to make sure that we can account for those emissions staying in the ground. So there's not leakage. That's a good thing. That's a protocol issue. But it's a recognition that that is a good technology to deal with climate change and CO2 emissions going to the atmosphere. So that's, I think it's wonderful. I wished we would get on with it because we've been working on it for 7 years.
Todd, you had a comment
on that? Sure, so I just wanted to point out, I think Gene, you mentioned high heating valve fuels earlier. For most of the United States, which still generates electricity using a lot of coal, it makes a lot of sense economically to try to capture the carbon from burning the coal and store it. Now, California, PG doesn't have any electricity burned from coal. California has very little. It's mostly imported. It's actually practically illegal to have a long-term contract with a coal-burning power plant in California right now. It wasn't AB 32. SB was at 1368, okay? And so actually for much of the country, it makes a lot of economic sense and promise. For California, maybe not so much, because natural gas has far less carbon content in terms of emissions than coal does. And so is it promising for California? It depends as we go forward to see exactly how much it might cost and what the alternatives might be.
The HECA project tried to do it in Bakersfield for a very long time unsuccessfully because there wasn't the leadership in California to allow that to happen. It's a great technology, and I thought we really cared about any emissions that go into the atmosphere that relate to carbon, and this is certainly a good one to look at and pursue.
Could we blame that on PG&E? Didn't they not give them a contract?
I'm not blaming it on anyone. I'm just saying it's a great technology that needs to be pursued.
Good. All right, we do have different perspectives here. And other questions right here?
Ben Lubon, I'm a climate capitalist.
What is a climate capitalist?
Someone who knows the solutions that you're speaking of and how we can make lots more money and create more jobs.
Oh, lovely.
And capture and sequestration is the bane of my existence. Because it doesn't make sense to put something in the ground. But capture and reutilization. See, one man's waste is another man's treasure. What's coming out of your refineries, or what's the methane that's coming out of your power plants, or the coal? We can actually make clean coal. You know, we can reclaim the water. We can capture the emissions. And with those effluents, we can grow algae and green crude and mix it at the refinery. But it's reutilization.
Do you have a question?
Is who's aware of this? Who's aware of your reutilization? I'm sorry, I'm a lobbyist. I need to educate. When I hear something right there that, you know, we want sequestration, we need reutilization. So please.
Well, the oil industry had, of course, proposed to use sequestration to use it for extraction, and that was the plan in Saskatchewan, which has led to an enormous boondoggle in the province of Saskatchewan and their CCS plant, which is probably going to lead to the fall of the government. Now, if that's what's being proposed for California, well, I say good luck.
Yeah, that's exactly what I proposed, Paul. Thank you for restating that so clearly.
I would just offer, if your point about reuse and using waste in particular, the standard technology now for gas-fired power plants is actually a combined cycle power plant. And combined what? Uses a simple cycle peaker and basically uses the waste heat and gets more electricity out of it. And so that idea is proven technology, and it's the standard in natural gas-fired power plants. And so lots of great promising ideas to do that, and I look forward to hearing what else you may offer in the decades to come.
Good. Another question right here.
Yeah, Tom Franz, Shafter Farmer. Of course, HECO just withdrew their application today, so it's not going to happen. And that's very good news for us here in Kern County. But Mr. Strauss, can you assure me that I will never again, as you plan for 2050 and doubling your capacity and making it 100% renewable, will I ever have to go to the CEC again, California Energy Commission, to fight against a new fossil fuel power plant here in the San Joaquin Valley? Is that age over?
And so, can I assure anyone of anything going to 2050? I assure you, I cannot assure anyone of anything going to 2050. But you look to see natural gas-fired power plants, fossil fuel-fired power plants. What do we need them for, okay? When you look out towards 2020, 2030, and 2050, they're not likely to be running max out. They're not likely, we don't need them to be running in the middle of the day. Because even though we've got the air conditioners, we have lots of solar panels. So we actually might need some fossil-fired power plants to go up a little bit around 6 or 7 p.m. and turn off at 10 p.m. We might need them a little bit to turn on at 5 p.m. and then turn off at 8, turn on at 5 a.m. and turn off at 8 a.m. when the sun comes up. So unless we find a storage technology that can replace it, might be more cost effective, unless we can widen perhaps the market and get some of our neighbors, some who might be in slightly different time zones, slightly different climates, unless we can get some demand response, so people might reduce or increase their electricity use according to market price signals, we might actually need some of the existing power plants to operate a little bit differently. The future, no one is planning at this moment for lots of additional gas-fired power plants, but you never know. And so they're likely to be operated quite differently from what we've seen to date. So don't know if that's reassuring to you, but that's the nature of the future.
I think we have time for
Jim Scott, 17 News. Stored hydro is one example of storing renewable energy, pumping the water back up the hill, let it come down through the turbines. But isn't it true that to realize the full potential of renewable energy anywhere, you have to have a discussion about energy storage for renewable energy? Is anybody having that conversation in the halls of the legislature or Congress to aggressively pursue that storage for renewable energy in order to unleash the full potential of renewable energy?
Absolutely. I mean, California is again leading the way. It is the largest battery storage market in the world for electricity right now. There's actually a state mandate, it was AB 2514, that has become policy, and there's a target PG&E has to get 580 megawatts of innovative storage on the transmission system, distribution system, behind the meter by 2020 to be in place by 2024. And the intent is to enable the integration of renewables, but also California style, what's the intent? To transform the market, okay, and show the way that this could be done worldwide and to enable California jobs and California technology to be exported. So it's happening.
Yeah, Jim, I would like to follow up on that. We actually have quite a bit of storage in California now, particularly when PG&E closes the other reactor, the reactors at Diablo Canyon. We'll have a lot of pump storage available that we can use for renewables. And when Southern California Edison, of course, now that their reactors are offline because of their mismanagement, we have all their pump storage available for renewables in the state. I don't think we need a lot of storage. Most of the academic studies done now, most of the engineering work done now, and I think Todd was referring to this in terms of the scale that you see for storage, is that most of the thinking now is when you go to very high penetrations of renewable energy, such as I've been talking about, you don't need as much storage. Now, you may need 3% of fossil fuels, Kathy's natural gas, simple cycle, multiple cycle, simple cycle gas plants, you know, very expensive, but you only run them a few hours a year, so who cares? That's where most of the thinking is now, that you don't need as much storage as we thought. But the key is, and the key for you here in Bakersfield, the key for Senator Fuller and others, is you have to have a renewable energy policy. We don't have that in California. We don't have a renewable energy policy. We have an RPS, these acronyms that you were talking about, David. But we don't have a renewable energy policy because a renewable energy policy has to get you a mix of resources, just like PG&E and Edison and DWP and all these utilities had a mix of resources. They didn't have all coal. They didn't have all hydro. They didn't have all gas. They had a mix of coal, a mix of oil, a mix of hydro.
And that's what we need with renewables. We need the geothermal we have in Kern County. We're not even developing geothermal in this state anymore. We need the biomass plants. We're closing the biomass plants instead of opening new ones. We need biogas plants. We've got all those cows out there with all that manure that's polluting the environment, and I hope Dean can do something about that, making that generation of electricity with all that manure instead of breathing it when you're on a train. So we need a renewable energy policy in this state so that we have all those renewables, and so it's the mix that's critical. It's that mix. And this is where we need people like Todd and others who are analyzing the details of how you do that.
Thank
whether
you.
60% Thank wind, so let's 30% solar, you need the mix
question.
Of resources. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I just weigh in what actually
yeah.
goes on that I've heard
Thank
in the
you.
Halls of the Senate? Okay. Number one, absolutely, that is the key component. And there will have to be more breakthroughs and discussions on that. So far, the failed discussion didn't work. It's not anybody's fault it failed. I'm not blaming that. I'm just saying it happened and it failed. And that was to get Tesla's batteries up, because they're doing these long-term batteries that they put under the cars, and then you change them out, and they're huge. And they kind of fell apart when they decided to go to Reno, because it was cheaper to make them in Reno. So they're making them in Reno now. So we don't talk about that now. Okay, so then the next thing was the duck chart's been coming around from the CPUC, and they've been sharing that with us, because the bottom line is everybody's really afraid of the excess daytime energy, not off-peak for renewables, but excess daytime energy, and when the wind blows, energy. And they're talking about, they sell it off currently to other states for way less than the cost of producing it, because they haven't figured out a way to store it. And so that's a huge cost to everybody, and other states who don't even have goals are getting the benefit of what we all paid to generate this stuff. So that is a policy problem. And the last is that, so I looked up who was actually doing this, and Texas under Governor Perry was researching batteries and doing it under a GoBiz program that we have there. And after I saw what they were doing, I was thinking we weren't ahead of anything. So anyway.
So we're into overtime here.
Well,
but
let me go back to Senator Fuller's Fuller's comment, because I think it's pertinent. She lamented the loss of the Tesla plant, and I think we should lament the loss of the Tesla plant in California. That was a big mistake, letting that plant go to Nevada. But we have an opportunity to do something even bigger. And that is, you all remember what happened with Volkswagen. They cheated on our emission standards in the United States. 35 times the emissions were emitted from the diesel engines of Volkswagen. They were caught with their pants down. So what's the penalty they're going to pay? Well, I'm suggesting, and now it's being rumored in Germany, that EPA, and I hope CARB, will be insisting that to make amends, Volkswagen will have to build an electric vehicle plant in the United States. And I ask Senator Fuller, and I ask CARB, and I would ask Barack Obama and the EPA to ensure that that plant is built where the market for electric cars exists today, and that's in California, and I suggest we build it in Bakersfield.
Okay, well, we're going to end on a high note. Okay, Todd, a quick comment.
Just want to add something there, because you mentioned Texas, and you know, the reality is we learn from everybody. Just note there's a program in Texas to give away electricity for free at night, because they have plenty of wind power at night in West Texas, and it doesn't cost anything to generate that electricity, and so they give it away for free. And so it's like, we might think about that, because actually the wholesale price in California of electricity is sometimes negative, that is, you pay to generate in the middle of the day. And so we need to think pretty differently about the future and even the present from what the past was.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, thank you very much. And thank you all for coming. And please join me in giving a big hand to this panel.
Available to us.
Thanks, Todd. It was good to have you up here.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kathy.
You're
welcome. We'll see you later.
Thank you, too.
You have an easier job than Mary will next week.
Thanks again to Dave Lesher for and CALmatters for hosting this and moderating the event today. Thank you, Dave.